This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Lyttelton Rail Tunnel, initially called the Moorhouse Tunnel, links the city of Christchurch with the port of Lyttelton in the Canterbury region of New Zealand's South Island. It is the country's oldest operational rail tunnel, and is on the Lyttelton Line, one of the first in the province. On completion in 1867, it became the first tunnel in the world to be taken through the side of an extinct volcano, and at 27. Background: Canterbury's first settlers had two options for transporting themselves and their goods between the harbour at Lyttelton and the Canterbury Plains: the bridle path over the Port Hills, or by ship over the Sumner Bar, then up either the Heathcote or Avon rivers. It was therefore with concern over access to the plains that the Canterbury Provincial Council, formed in November 1853, established 4 months later a commission to examine the options for improvement. Only one road route was considered feasible, the Sumner Road passing under the summit of Evans Pass via a 350-yard tunnel. There were two contenders for the rail line: a direct route down the Heathcote Valley and through a 25. The provincial commission that had been established to implement the recommendations of the council, chaired by W. B. Bray, set about investigating the two railway proposals that had earlier been considered. West and east of Mount Pleasant, provincial engineer Edward Dobson favoured the latter route, as it meant that Gollins Bay could be used to berth ships at a deepwater jetty without having to dredge the area. However, there were several factors against the Gollins Bay route that had to be considered, not least that it bypassed Lyttelton, a growing commercial centre of some importance, its exposure to the wind, and the lack of suitable land at the bay for port facilities. Though the commission considered it to be the best route to the harbour, they discounted the route and decided against a detailed survey of it, as their terms of reference had tasked them with finding a route to Lyttelton. The report from George Robert Stevenson, a consulting engineer to the provincial commission, was largely in favour of the Bray route, and made the following points: it was the shortest route, providing access to all necessary points, construction costs would be 32% less than the alternative, it would be cheaper to work, and less expensive to maintain. The only point he noted in favor of the route via Gollins Bay was that it would take 3 years to construct as opposed to 5 years for the direct route. Having considered the available data, the commission adopted the report from Stevenson and requested that he obtain a tender from a suitable English contractor. Popular support. Superintendent Moorhouse became a strong proponent of the tunnel project during the campaign for election of the provincial superintendent in 1857. The tunnel became the central issue, with Moorhouse's opponent, Joseph Britton, being opposed to the idea. Moorhouse received much support for his position from the residents of Lyttelton, as evidenced by the results of the election. Of the 12,000 residents of Canterbury, including 3,205 in Christchurch and 1,944 in Lyttelton, both candidates received 206 votes from the residents of Christchurch. However, overall results were a victory for Moorhouse by 727 votes to 352. Moorhouse later began the project by turning the first sod on 17 July 1861. Construction. See also, Canterbury Provincial Railways. Lyttelton portal of the rail tunnel with construction workers in 1867. Stevenson retained the services of English contractors John Smith and George Knight, who had agreed to complete the project within 5 years. They dispatched an agent, chief miner, and a party of 12 miners to New Zealand near the end of 1859. On arrival in Canterbury, Smith threw than what they had been led to believe they would encounter from samples that had been sent back to England. Given this new information, they concluded that it would not be possible to complete the contract for the original amount, and they sought an additional £30,000 to complete the work. After consulting with the provincial engineers, the Canterbury government decided not to proceed with the services of Smith Ends, which would eventually drain the excess water. The work commenced with 340 men at an estimated cost of £42,800. Only 96 yards had been driven in the shafts before the next contractors took over the work. 6 months later, Moorhouse continued to advocate for the railway, suggesting that the government seek to raise a loan for the project, and to engage the services of a competent and responsible contracting firm to undertake the works at the behest of the council. Moorhouse travelled to Melbourne, Australia in January 1861. On his return in May, he brought with him news of success on both counts of the three contractors approached by Moorhouse to tender for the work. The two lowest priced were discounted, leaving the highest tender, that of Holmes Southern Railway, 9,166 chains of the 13,066 chain total length had been bored whole through was achieved on the morning of 28 May 1867 from the Littleton heading to the Heathcote side. Temporary rails had been laid through the tunnel by mid-November, enabling the passage of the first locomotive, No. 3. On the night of 18 November the first goods train through the tunnel was headed by No. 3 and driven by Abraham Beverly a week later, to be followed by passenger services on the 9th of December. The tunnel was not considered complete until June 1874, by which time the government had outlaid a further £20,710 on maintenance proposal. The railways department gave consideration to the idea of duplicating the tunnel in 1914, but the proposal did not proceed. Operation C also, Littleton Line and NZREC class. At the time the colonial government decided to implement a national railway gauge, they made exceptions for some existing railway systems that had already been laid using different gauges, generally on the proviso that any new track was to the national gauge. One such system was the railways of the Canterbury Province, which were brought under the jurisdiction of a special Act of Parliament, the Canterbury Gauge Act. This act made provision for the regauging of existing lines by laying a third rail between the two existing rails to allow for the use of narrow gauge rolling stock on the same track rather than incur the inconvenience of this approach. The provincial government decided to lay a new narrow gauge line beside the existing broad gauge line from Addington to Littleton. The narrow gauge line reached Christchurch on 7 March 1876 and Littleton 34 days later. The nuisance of smoke in the tunnel created by steam locomotives prompted attempts by the railways department to alleviate the problem. In August 1909, they had locomotive WF-433 converted to oil burning to reduce the amount of smoke produced. The locomotive was used for a trial period to haul 450-ton goods trains through the tunnel. Though the modification proved to be efficacious, the benefit did not outweigh the cost involved and the idea was abandoned. The second attempt was to electrify the line from Christchurch to Littleton following the successful electrification of the Otira Tunnel in 1923, and a report recommending electrification of the suburban networks of New Zealand's four main cities, it was decided to electrify the Christchurch-Littleton route using the same system as had been used at Otira. Fortunately, because the tunnel had originally been built to accommodate the provincial railway's larger broad-gauge rolling stock, the tunnel was already sufficiently large enough to accommodate the overhead catenary without modification. The first electric train ran from Christchurch to Littleton on 14 February 1929. Electrification lasted until 1970, by which time the EC class electric locomotives had reached the end of their working lives. With the decline in rail services after the opening of the Littleton Road Tunnel in 1964, and with dieselization almost complete and only a few steam locomotives left in revenue service, the electrification system was scrapped in favor of diesel haulage. Today the tunnel is the exclusive domain of freight trains, with six scheduled daily return services from the port of Littleton through the tunnel, including coal trains from Hector and Nakawau via the Seddonville branch on the west coast. The Heathcote end can be accessed by foot from Station Road, and a strong smell of smoke can be smelt, which would make breathing difficult in the tunnel. Schedule times of trains going through the tunnel can be observed from the railway company. Additional shunts convey other traffic between the city and the port. References: Carrot, Historic Littleton Buildings, Christchurch City Council, retrieved 2 April 2011. Carrot, Littleton Rail Tunnel, 125th Anniversary Commemorative Booklet, Christchurch, the Ferrymead Trust. Tunnel, the Littleton Rail Tunnel article.